and switch to the final speaker. That is Professor Giacinto Scoles from the University of Udine in Italy, and simultaneously also affiliated with the University of Philadelphia in the US. And he will introduce us into some new approaches which are potentially useful for the detection of circulating tumor cells.
This will be for forward, that's for backward, and that's to turn the screen blank. And that will be a point. Yeah? So just try to say something. Yeah. Say something.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah, you can hear me now. I'd like to convince you today that there is a huge gap in diagnostic for cancer at present, and that we are about to fill it, that gap. And if you're not convinced, I'd like to have a very animated discussion at the end of my paper. This is going to be isolation and characterization of live CTCs, circulating tumor cells, from the peripheral blood of patients with metastatic breast cancer. Michele Bulfoni is doing his work with Daniela Ciselli in my group at Udine, and later on I will also relate to the work of Fabio Del Ben and Matteo Turetta, who worked directly with me, and in collaboration with Professor William Hook and Iger Spiruska of the University of Nijmegen. Metastatic tumors are the major cause of cancer associated with mortality, as everyone knows. Metastatic can differ greatly from the primary tumor. Metastasis can change any consequence of therapy. Taking biopsies from metastable metastasis is in patients is very difficult sometimes, is very invasive and not. Basic cancer diagnostic is the weak link. To slow down, it is too slow and too expensive. It takes up to 4 months to see. 4 months is the maximum at present because the imaging is improving every day to see if the therapy is working. And that's not acceptable. I'd like to convince you of this. I ask you to think about it. Suppose there is a limit zero time between when you think about a therapy and when you know if this works. Then the problem is solved because you have all the therapies available and eventually find one that works. But that's not, of course, not going to be the case even in our case. But that's exactly why we are putting so much emphasis in going in that direction. Little biopsies are minimally invasive approaches to monitor tumor genome evolution. You can have circulating tumor cells, circulating DNA fragments, and circulating exosomes. Basically, the important sentence here is the last one by Klaus Pantel in the Nature Biotechnology Review. The goal of characterizing solid tumor genomes with nothing more than a blood sample is now within reach. Clinical validity of circulating tumor cell in patients with metastatic breast cancer, a pooled analysis of individual patient data. A again, the important is the last sentence. It says, this data confirmed independent prognostic effect of CTCs, count on progression-free survival, and overall survival CTCs count also improves the prognostication of metastatic breast cancer when added to full clinical pathological predictive models, whereas serum tumors mark do not. Now, serum tumor markers are also making some progress at present, but basically they lag behind the CTCs. The gold standard at present is the only FDA-approved machine, is the Feridex machine. And that's, I was convinced that going in this direction when I saw an advertised piece on the web where it shows that for a patient, was two or three analyses were sufficient to make it better outcome. But then it doesn't get done. Why doesn't it get done for every patient? I think the excuse is expensive. It's not very valid because it's not a very expensive test. It's $500. And most of the tests, which however are applied much less frequently, are more expensive, like PET scan and so on, things like this. But if you want to use one of these tests as a therapy monitor, you have to do it more, many more. So one before the therapy, one during the therapy, after, and several tests. So it becomes very expensive. And then the limit of this machine is actually that there are only 8 analyses per day. For a large hospital, it's certainly not enough. You need 10 machines, that each machine costs $500,000. That's too much. Low throughput, arthritis epithelial, actually the blue point, they are only based on EPCAM antibodies that single out epithelial cells. Epithelial cells are part of the story. Mesenchymal cells are not included. I will show you in a moment what that means in terms of diagnostics. The most severe limit, is, in my opinion, is that one. Cells are not very viable after the sorting. Again, are not a big limit. Here you have epithelial cells. Just a moment. Epithelial cells. Epithelial to mesenchymal. Epithelial equal to mesenchymal. Mesenchymal to epithelial, and mesenchymal cells. Now you have the results here. For instance, for patient number 15, Veridex machine would have said zero circulating tumor cells, because all mesenchymal cells. But instead, there are quite a bit of them, 15, which are above the limit of good prediction, predictive values for them. Assuming that for the mesenchymal cells, which is probably not yet established because nobody has measured them carefully enough to establish what the limits are for going to progression-free survival or overall survival. But in the beginning, yes. If you have, for instance, as you will see in the next, that's what we want to do. Optimization is a relation strategy going beyond the EPCAM. Viable cell sorting. We will do that in the beginning with the parade, but the parade is going to be very slow and expensive also. But at least we'll go beyond EPCAM. We'll include mesenchymal cells. Characterization, epithelial mesenchymal transition, expensive the antibody-based technique, and still slow. Drug response, and single cell genomics. We won't include the characterization. Single cell genomics is being still in progress. Clinical validation. Okay. Patient enrollment. We have 130 patients in Udine. And we have included measurable metastatic breast cancer, beginning of a new line of system therapy with no restriction on the previous therapies, availability of histology specimens for the primary tumor. This is conditioned to belong to the cohort. We have about halfway to the cohort at present. Workflow, detection and count. Detection and count we do with the DEP array. DEP array is a machine which is complex and very costly, and it has also very costly use of chemicals, but it works very nicely. And you can, two epithelial markers, one mesenchymal markers, three mesenchymal markers, and then other type of markers. CTC sorting. Here you are. Okay. DAPI. And then you look at the cells in all field. Then you have mesenchymal cells, epithelial, mixed, and lymphatic, and a negative cell. This is just impurity or something we don't know about. Yes, thank you. Thank you. Yeah. The beginning, we have an explanation why Veridex machine has been so useful after all, because most studies have been done with it, because there are several cancers where the mesenchymal percentage is equal to the epithelial ones, and therefore counting one or the other, counting both is the same. And these are listed there. But for instance, when you go to percentage of CTCs with the chemical markers, if there are 150%, and the mortality is very large. 50 to 60% of mortality. This is separation, which is better than the separation of the five cells per 7 cubic cc's, as we have in the original paper of Cristofanilli. Conclusions: the parade can do these things, but the metric is too slow. So we need a solution, but we need to make it faster and lower cost. Now is the work of Fabio Del Ben and Matteo Turetta, both medical doctors that are two physics in my laboratory. I give them some guidance, but basically very difficult to guide because they are medical doctors. They don't accept any direction from a physicist, and they go their own way. They are very good, though, as you will see in a moment. They came back to me and say, you want to monitor this thing? We use the Warburg effect. Warburg effect is well known. It's more, almost 100 years. It's the consumption of sugar. It goes into acidity of the cells instead of going to pyruvic acid and other and ATPs and production of other things. Instead of going to energy, it goes into growth of the cell, basically. Exploiting my effect at the single cell level, I told them how to do it. I remember a paper by Hook I saw in Cambridge, in England, sometime years ago, where he was doing single cell treatment into a drop of water, making the motion in this way, as you can see there. Oil, cell, here, and they go like this. Then you put them here, around here, in a sheet of light, and you get, you go to see if it's acidic or not, after 10 minutes after exposure to sugar. Then you can sort them out, because you can have here, so many microseconds after the light sheet, you can have a pulse of current here, and they go like this, otherwise they go like that. And here, in a static test, not in a test like this one, you can collect them and then make a photograph and count the ones with acidic, there is fluorescence, it means the droplets are acidic, the others are not, and so you can count them, easy. This, we call it Cytofind 1. It's our first machine which we're going to build. And there will be a machine for research where we sort them out and we do all kind of genomic analysis on them. Sorry. This is the calibration of the acidity, very precisely done. Can we discriminate between cells, white blood cells? Of course we can, so we'll be telling you. White blood cells are here, no acidity. And this is a line of cells. These are not responding, these are empty droplets, typically empty droplets. Or the incubation will not be long enough and think of this, but this is various cancer lines, incubated 10 minutes, and with lots of cells, of course. Can we detect in patients now? It's the important, most important slide of the whole talk. Yes, we can. Healthy donor here, no cells. Oh, sorry. Healthy donors here, no cells. Cancer spike, we have cells in acidity. And this is a colorectal cancer patient. So you can see the results speak by themselves. You can read this stuff and then decide by yourself if there is cancer cells or not in there. And you can do is use this also for early detection of cancer, because suppose you have a growth in your chest, like I have at present, I'm not going to get worried until I don't get circulating blood cells, cancer cells. If I'm not, I'm not going to have anybody poking biopsies in my chest and doing things like this. And if I have circulating blood cells, I run to the surgeon and get it tested, but not before. So the quality of life can improve substantially. You can improve in many ways. When you do a chemotherapy, you will know a week or so if it's working or not. Of course, everything has to be tested, but so far, every my imagination of how this thing would go has been proven. Huh? And the two doctors are sufficiently mad at me from time to time. I told you, cannot be different than this, because it's logic. If this cells are coming from the tumor, they have to show it. And now we see. We have made up a company. In October, we're going to raise money. Make the first cytofinder one, the one with the table, and counting only. Then we do the research machine, and we have validation. We give it to doctors around for validation clinically. We'll see what happens. I claim this is going to revolutionize diagnostic in cancer. I may be wrong. We'll see. Thank you.
Yes, thank you very much for this nice presentation. Maybe I can immediately get rid of a question. So this kind of labeling or the pH measurement, that would be compatible also with, for example, the DAP array or the cell search system?
Yes, we plan to do the following, actually. If it's not easy to make the DAP array interface with our microfluidics, but if we can, in collaboration with the people of the DAP array, we want to do that. Because the DAP array is low in selecting the cells, and it takes hours and so on. And then, but then it's very systematic, because it can manipulate the cells, separate them, and do the analysis and so forth. We plan to make our microfluidic machine with the sorting cells, enter in the DAP array, and then go in there.
Although the microfluidics itself would be much cheaper than, of course, buying the machine and...
It's much cheaper, but yes. You don't need, when you want the number of mesenchymal cells included, after you tested a few times and you characterized a few times and you know that certain cancer only mesenchymal, others certain, depending on the profile of the patient, then you know how it goes.
But you don't know yet whether it is the mesenchymal cells or the epithelial cells or both which are more acidic?
No, they're acidic equally, as far as you know.
Okay, yep.
They are equally
independent
acidic.
Of the
but what we don't know yet is the fact that if the which one are the most predictive of bad outcomes. I think both, actually, depending, because apparently the survival, let's see. No. There was a certain moment Daniele Cicelli has written certain sentences which are significant to answer your question. Okay. The number of CDCs expressing mesenchymal markers is thought to be a prognostic factor, both overall survival and progression-free survival. But the fraction of epithelial cells expressing mesenchymal markers seems to be correlated with overall survival.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah. What is first this time?
Oh, okay. Really good. Really, really great work. One of the things that I was curious is, have you been able to follow any cancer over time to see whether or not you can actually see the peak increase and then decrease during treatment?
No, we have not.
You haven't done that far yet.
Not done. I push you to do that as fast as possible, because
it'll
be convincing to everyone that the thing is useful, tremendously useful, but not yet. These two guys are very careful. They go on their own pace and they want to hear from me.
Have you thought about going to the blood bank and seeing whether or not they had some blood that was stored that you could actually do this with?
We have to first validate the analysis, the metabolic analysis done with the blood bank cells, which I don't know if it's valid or not. But we'll try, definitely. Other people may have done similar things, but for other purposes.
Are you aware that your data is quite contrary to a lot of measurements made in vivo using MRS?
I'm sorry, I cannot.
Are you aware that your data is quite contrary to a lot of measurements done using using the method of magnetic resonance spectroscopy, which show indeed that tumors are extracellularly acidic, but the intracellular pH is normal? So, which is explained by the fact that cells want to keep their pH normal as much as possible. In fact, they even tend to be higher than normal cells. So your data where you're looking at isolated cells is actually contrary to that. But are you saying that maybe there's just very low number of cells that have this extremely acidic pH and therefore wouldn't be picked up by such an in vivo approach?
For the bulk of the number of cells, I put my hands on the fire for this, but there are a few cells that are looking mysterious. Some very high acidity, two or three, sometimes, not always. And others, I don't know what are you referring to. I will study the reference that you will give me, please, and then we'll see.
Well, if you look at any of the literature from about 1985 onwards, done by the method of MRS, you'll find a lot of information about intracellular and extracellular pH of tumors.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. First of all, I think you did something that people ignore. You did something that many people ignore for a long time, yes. Is to use the tumor metabolism, go back to Warburg effect and other things.
Yes.
But I think there are many, many, many other things related to tumor metabolism that can be used not only for diagnostic, also for therapeutic use, and no one really pay attention to them.
Yes.
But I think what you say, what the guy before me said is correct, and actually the tumor cells have a special mechanism to enable them to keep the internal pH high enough while taking advantage of the acidic pH of the medium, so they can survive much better under this condition than the regular cell that don't have this mechanism to keep the pH high.
Mm-hmm.
So actually, today there are new methods for imaging are developed in which we can determine the ability of cells to make these metabolites that enable the cells to keep the pH high. And by using this, you can be more selective with different imaging techniques, especially PET scan. You can get a much better result than you could get before.
Simple machine. Now we go over there. I cheat on the microscope to analyze this, and we do not have too much resolution. But with the fiber optic machine that will have better resolution, we can make analysis of the cells and of the water outside, and gradients of acidity will be coming out of that. Then we will see.
Good. I think facing the time, we should close the session now. If there are further questions to discuss, of course, the break for that offers. I would like to thank again all the speakers for their very nice and informative contributions. And thank you all for joining.